Hello everyone, thanks for coming here, and next talk will be about something new added to cryptsetup or the cryptsetup tools, because there are several tools. But I should mention the idea behind the integrated protection was actually academic idea in the first place. I do some research for PhD study, but because I'm cryptsetup maintainer, I would like in the end something practical. And actually, it seems that we have something practical before the publication of some papers. So the talk is what you can do with that, and maybe play with that, and maybe find it useful. So the talk here is just for some introduction. I try to do with some pictures, not with mathematics or some complicated. We will see if it works. Then I will describe what is new device mapper integrity module that is already in upstream kernel, so you can play with that. What is the authenticated encryption for dm-crypt? That's another extension. And also we will maybe shortly talk about Lux version 2, but I have only two slides in the end because Lux is really about key management, and I will be talking about the real encryption. But I promised it in abstract, so let's try to do that. So just very short introduction, what is full disk encryption? Full disk encryption is actually encryption on the lowest layer of the stack, storage stack, so on the disk sector level. And usually it's transparent, so you can put it in the chain of encryption or the sectors. So we have some limitations there, but also the implementation is usually quite simpler than implementation, for example, in file systems. As I said, the encryption is on sector level, so we are limited by the sector size. Sectors are always accessed independently, so you cannot have any interdependence between the sectors as the block device it operates with that. Full disk encryption initially and still is mainly used for data address protection, so it means it's designed to protect your data when device is switched offline. And usually the threat model I will mention later is that if someone stores your device, the data are still safe. So it provides confidentiality, but by the design, it doesn't provide data integrity and data integrity protection. What I mean by that, we will see there, but the reason for it is that we have so-called rank preserved encryption, so the ciphertext, the size of the sector is the same as the plain text, and we have actually no space to store any integrity information or authenticated information. That's one of the problems I'm trying to solve here. So let's start with the pictures. Just maybe explanation, it looks like glitch art, but it's not glitch art. It's really generated using dm-crypt in kernel and cryptsetup. If you see some talks about encryption, you will usually see the encrypted talks with ECB mode. I will start with that as well. But we have some another pictures trying to show what it's about. So the technically it's bitmap image, because bitmap doesn't have any integrity check, so it will allow me to display even the ciphertext. So for the start, just simple text, it's all plain text, and the correct encryption should look like something like this, just pseudo random noise. You shouldn't see any patterns. Actually, this is the encryption with ISXT mode, but with initialization vector with sector number. So usually all of most of the encryption systems today on various operation systems are running in this mode. So this is how it should look like. This one is actually, you probably recognize some pattern if you use electronic codebook. Electronic codebook is the mode that shouldn't be never used for the basic encryption. In principle is that you will just split the plain text in blocks of encryption size here in 16 bytes and run the encryption without any tweaking. So if there is some plain text, there will be some ciphertext, and of course in the image there are some patterns. That's very known and you shouldn't do that, but unfortunately there is millions of drives using chip encryption that are running exactly this way. So it's not just academic fun. Someone in some big corporation actually used that for big series of drives. Whatever, the second picture is something I would like to demonstrate. It's not only mode, it's also the tweaking value. You really want to have the same plain text encrypted differently on different place of the disk. And if you see on this picture, I use actually XTS mode, so some quite secure mode. We will talk about some problems with XTS later. But here, I just use constant initialization vector. That's the tweak value for the sector. Because it's constant and the internal operation of XTS, you can see the pattern just in something different. So not only encryption algorithm, encryption mode, but also the tweaking value, and later in authenticated encryption, it's called nonce, is important to security of encryption. And I would like to show you how, what is data integrity here on the picture. What I play is here is that I take that ciphertext, that's the image of the disk, and just implanted some picture there. I just wiped some byte with some constant value, so I'm playing with the disk without the key, just rewriting the ciphertext, and then keep user to decrypt it in the plaintext form. You can clearly see that the parts I rewrite were decrypted as some pseudo-random noise. But also you can see that I implanted some additional information there, the picture of some pirate flag or something like that. It's quite a stupid example here, but I would like to say that it can be more sophisticated. Someone just can take, for example, a hidden disk, if you know that TrueCrypt concept, and implant in your encrypted device, and then later prove that your device actually contains some data you have no idea about. And because it's length-preserving encryption, your system have no way how to recognize that because there are no checksums, there are no authenticated encryption, nothing. Maybe it's not a problem, but our solution is based on the threat model that just thinks it's a problem. So threat model, just very, very simplific view. The usual encryption, this encryption threat model is designed for a stolen device, so someone stores your laptop, your disk, data are gone, they are never used again, so the confidentiality is perfectly fine. He cannot decrypt the data and your data is safe, so lost only hardware. But if the device returns to original original owner, you can have problem because there can be some silent data corruption, so a random data corruption, actually you have no idea how to detect. You should detect it on the upper layer, but as you see with that picture, it's not always the case. But also, as I said, attacker can implant some external data there, and if you think that this situation is just academic exercise, just remember how many times your device travels separately from you and how many times you are forced to put laptop in some baggage and so on. So yes, I know there can be the hardware attacks, you and some keylogger can be installed, but this what I mentioned is just manipulation with the software. So it's not excuse, we shouldn't take care about some data integrity here actually. And another trade-offs I would like to mention, just because we are trying to maybe fix them as well. First one, that actually you would expect with this encryption that on every write to the sector on the disk will change pseudo-randomly. So attacker can always detect with the snapshot that the sector was changed. That's actually the same with the disk drive. You see the sectors, which sectors are changed. But you shouldn't be able to locate the change with a larger granularity than the sector size. And that's not the truth with all modern, most of the modern disencryption, because the operation of the XTS mode and similar modes. And the second problem is, because there is no additional randomized information for the sector, the same plaintext written to the same place on the disk will always produce the same ciphertext. So attacker can actually detect that you are writing the same data. In cryptography, if we would play with some Oracle model, I would say it's a chosen plaintext attack, but let's not talk about cryptography. I will show it on picture. Just one thing here. There are also replay attacks. It means that someone is able to take old valid data and put it back on the disk, either the whole disk or just part of it, and you are not able to recognize that. Solving this problem is much more problematic than others, because for solving this problem, you need to have additional trusted store to store something like counter, last modified date, or the hash of the Mercator Merkle tree is tree of the hashes, and the top level hash is stored somewhere. Chromebooks use it for system partition, for example. We are not solving that because our requirement is that we work just with standard drives and don't have any ability to store it. Just warning in advance. So I promised some pictures. So there is another one. Actually, it's not encryption. I just reversed the following block. So I would like to demonstrate what is the encryption block granularity. So on the left side, you can see the IS block with 16 bytes. So if you imagine that ECB encryption pattern, that's the reason why we see this pattern there. On the right side is the 4 kilobyte block disk sector with the same way. So that took something around 60 kilobytes of data, so you can see how it propagates here. What is more interesting, if I apply it to the real situation, so I would have the same encrypted disk, and I, as user, just run some operation. I just selected something very simple, so I overwrite every 64 byte sector in plain text, and then I run the difference between the old ciphertext, so all the disk, and the new ciphertext. You would expect that everything will pseudo-randomly change because 64 byte is inside each sector on the disk. The reality is what you can see on the left. Actually, the XTAce mod has, for performance reasons, some different structure, and it encrypts the data internally in parallel, similar to ECB mod. And you can clearly see that I can locate the change up to the IS block. The white spaces are unchanged areas. It can be problem. It cannot be problem. Sometimes it's called leak by XTAce mod in some articles or analysis. I don't think it's problem, but I would like to do something with that if it's possible. When I generate this picture, I know that there is some even unchanged part of the blocks. I was too lazy. I just was overwriting the disk with the constant value. In this case, I just overwrite the same value what was already there. So, of course, it didn't change. Just if you are interested why there is some pattern even inside that, inside the change pattern. So what we can do with that, solution is that we will somehow randomize that tweak value for the sector, randomize the initialization vector. Actually, I tried it. It's implemented in kernel now, and then you can see what happens here. So expected output, everything pseudo-randomly changing. But there are some problems with it we will see later. So what's missing? If I would like to provide some data integrity protection on this level, so block level, I would have to use, instead of length preserving encryption, I need to use authenticated encryption if we want to be cryptographically safe, or authenticated encryption with additional data. That's that variation there. The ciphertext change granularity problem can be solved by using randomized IV, like I showed you. It can or can be used by use so-called white encryption modes. White encryption modes means that the block of the mode is the same like the sector, so it will work as expected. But there are two problems with that. It's still length preserving encryption, and the second problem, most of the modes that are performance okay are patented and we cannot use them. So I am not playing with that, but maybe one day there will be mode we can actually use. There is EME2 mode, but still it's not sure if it's patent-free or not. Anyway, this, the last problem, as I mentioned, if we would like to ciphertext change, even if we are writing the same data, that can be solved again by randomization of initialization vector. All these problems together have one big problem, and that's it requires some additional metadata per sector. You need to store that randomized initialization vector somewhere. You need to store authentication tag somewhere. So that's the problem, major problem we are trying to solve. So before I start to describing how we did that, just all requirements that was defined before we even started to do that. Of course, we are not inventing the wheel. There are some solutions. I would like to mention FreeBSD solution for encryption combined with data integrity protection. This solution is nice, but is limited to some sector sizes and even to some algorithms. The problem is that increased sector size there. I mentioned that sector size today is 4 kilobytes. So if I would use that sector size, I would need to increase for the user space sector size to something bigger, and it will be bigger than page size inside most of the system. So there are problems with that. I don't use it, but I know about that, and it's quite nice solution, but we use something different. So our solution should be based on no special hardware. You should use just laptop as you want, as you have it today. We would like to use commercial off-the-shelf disks. With focus on SSD, you will see why, because on the rotational disk it will work, but it will have quite bad performance. What I would like to have even for the future is configurable per sector metadata. So if I decide that I will put not only data integrity detection checksum or authentication tag there, but I can put there even the forward error correction. So it will try to recover from that in the future maybe. So I would like to have the configurable so we can change algorithms, we can change way how to use that. I already mentioned that a native sector size in the whole storage stack should remain the same. And what is absolutely necessary is to have some protection to power failure, so we don't lose the data. The data corruption must not occur. We are writing actually data and metadata together, so this couple must be always keep in sync, even if the system crash. So this means we have to implement some kind of journal or something like that to prevent this situation. And from the cryptography point of view, the solution should be algorithm agnostic. Algorithms are changing specifically for authenticating encryption today. It's very area where are appearing new algorithms, so we shouldn't be anyhow tied to the specific algorithms. Of course, it should be free. So that's the part of introduction, and now what is the real part we implemented and what's actually already in code you can test. So the solution was that I tried to separate the crypto part and storage part. The storage part is the metadata handling, so implementation of the per-sector metadata. The crypto part should be implementation of the authenticated encryption inside dm-crypt. So we somehow split these two areas. And the first one is DM integrity, new kernel module for basically emulating per sector metadata. If you know that enterprise storage drives with half kilobyte plus 8 bytes, so 520 bytes sector size, that's something similar, just defined in software and with completely configurable interface, so we can have whatever metadata per sector we want. And we implemented it using internal kernel feature that was already there, that are actually using this enterprise disk and are able to, inside one structure you have data and you have metadata, integrity protected metadata. And we just use that for our use. Block level maintenance in kernel, maybe I think we are misused that, but it works and doesn't require any touch of the block level subsystem inside Linux kernel. So it was actually all the solution is embedded inside device mapper in kernel. So that's the first part, non-cryptographic one. Later we added standalone mode that DM integrity can actually calculate integrity data itself. I will show you an example of that, but it was not the first in the first idea. The first idea was to implement authenticated encryption, and so we have already dm-crypt as the provider for this encryption in kernel, so the solution there was just add to authenticating encryption and randomize initialization vector. And the last part was just wrapper, how to user-friendly use that without million parameters on command line, and that's implementation cryptsetup using new on-disk format. So how it internally works. DM integrity works somehow similar like DM verity, if you are familiar with that code, or something like that. It will format the device. The device structure is, there is some super block with persistent parameters, then there is a data area, and data areas is interleaved with data sectors and metadata sectors. Metadata sector can contain several metadata for the whole range of sectors, And these areas are basically interleaved on the disk. The reason why I'm interleaving it here, we can just increase the size of the device online just in some steps. If we have stored it separately, it will be much complicated. Then there is a journal area that provides the journaling of the data. Journal can be switched off if you have journaling on the upper layer, but the area is still on disk. Usually it's fraction of the device size, something around 80 megabytes or something like that. Everything is configurable, so you can play with the parameters, how to format it. Just for information, I will first show that standalone mode. This is how many storage is used for the metadata. So if we are stick with the non-cryptographic metadata, just prevention to random bit flips or something like that, it's under 1% of storage. It's quite good. The problem is, of course, then later with performance. So standalone mode, data integrity, because there is no key, there is no encryption, it is really designed just for detecting random errors. So it works that on reads, it validates the checksum, on writes, it updates the checksum, and that's actually all. We designed, and I finally wrote it for cryptsetup tools, and a special tool to configure dm integrity in standalone mode. The tool is called cryptsetup and can be used quite simply. This is just example from some virtual machine. So you will format the device, you can specify the algorithm and all parameters. I just use default here. Just there is one problem. If you format it for integrity protection, the all integrity checksums there are just not initialized. So every write on that not yet written device will return integrity failure, of course, because there is not yet initialized the parity or checksum. So by default, it tries to wipe the whole device with zeros, wiping device to initialize integrity checksum, because later you can have some problems. That's problems that will probably appear once people are trying to use that, because you can have integrity failure even if you are reading just part of the device, because you have page cache in kernel, and page cache can generate reads itself, because it will increase the read to the page size, and if some sector in that area is not yet initialized, you will receive a data read error, integrity error, where you would not expect it. So that's why I am trying to prevent it, but probably file system should be aware of accessing the disk in page sizes and should work. It's not completely true, but that's maybe it's nice tool to discover some mistakes in implementation of various systems. We will see later. Anyway, it works the way you format it, you open it, and there is some status, so you will see the tag size, which algorithms use, and some journal parameters. That's actually just status of that. And then you can use the device as normal logical volume or something like that. But it's only protection to random data changes. For authenticated encryption, we have to use dm-crypt on top of dm integrity. So dm integrity provides metadata, dm-crypt provides authenticated encryption. And authenticated encryption must be somehow defined what it's doing. So I define some very simple, I try to keep it really simple without any complicated design. So this is our authenticated encrypts. Every sector will basically process it as this request. And as you can see, the additional AAD is additional authenticated data. We have, that's our additional data that are authenticated but not encrypted. They are just authenticated and not stored anywhere. We must authenticate it always sector number, because that's for sector misplacement. If you take one sector, move it on another area and disk, even with that initialization vector, you should get integrity failure. That's not allowed operation. So that's why we are authenticating sector. Then there is encryption area. We are authenticating initialization vector as well. That's actually not needed, but it's according to some different IEEE standard, and it's more safe that you will return authentication failure earlier. And the encryption produces the authentication tag, decryption just verifies this tag. So if there is any authentication error, you shouldn't receive the decrypted data, you will receive just authentication fail. or integrity fail. So that was how it works, this request, and we need to use, for every request, we need to use some randomized initialization vector. There are, that's the tweak for the sector. There are several possible solutions. I just choose the simplest one. I am just generating the whole random initialization vector from the random generator. And that's one important thing. We have to do that way that the collision probability, so collision is then you produce the same random number for two sectors, even in the history of the drive, it must not happen. So collision probability must be negligible from the cryptographic point of view. And as you can see in next slide, it's actually a problem with today's algorithms in kernel, and we have to do something with that. Just again, I mentioned this solution doesn't prevent replay attacks. You can take part of the old device and with correct checksums put it there, it will not detect them. That's not solution for this. We need separate trusted storage to implement that, so I ignore this problem. So what's the mentioned problem with authentication algorithms? I'm not saying the algorithms in a kernel are bad. They are actually very good and they are designed for network encryption, so authenticated transmission on network where you have no problem to do some leaking after several packets, or you have no problem with counter then just increases and there is no collision. But if you have disk, you have the whole disk and you are reading sector one, then sector million, that again sector one, and you are actually running back in time. On network you cannot do that. And for this, if I store the initialization vector on the disk itself, I just need to prevent collision there. So for that, I need long enough NANDs, so I would need to write a lot of data before the probability of the collision is not negligible. Unfortunately, all of the implementation of authenticated algorithms inside kernel, specifically GCM, use 96-bit NANDs, and with this, there is a problem that after writing, I think, it depends on sector size, but with 4 kilo sector sizes, if I remember correctly, it's over 100 petabytes of disk of written data when you probability with playing with some birthday paradox, you will get the collision. The reality will be even worse, and even there is some problems that you shouldn't use so many writes with the GCM. So GCM is not usable, specifically because if there is collision, it not only breaks the integrity for that particular sector, but there is no attack that will reveal part or the whole key. What's the worst case? It can happen. If you have the key, you can do anything. So GCM in this state, in kernel, it's not usable. Unfortunately, even the ChaCha20, if you like the Bernstein designed modes, has the same problem. We are actually using it in some wrapper according to this RFC. It has, again, 96-bit NANDs. So it can be used, but the probability of collision is so not perfect as we would like. So what's the possible solution? First solution is just don't use authenticating mode, just use the length present with mode and add some HMAC or keyed hash. So just calculate the integrity separately. That's the first item here. I will show you how to do that, but the major problem with it is too slow, and it will always be slow, because if you want to calculate integrity separately, for example, with hashing, HMAC, you have to hash the whole sector, and hashing of 4 kilobytes of data will always take some time. So it works, it's safe, but I would not basically use that as default, but that's not end of the world. There is a Cesar competition for cryptography authenticated algorithms, and actually it's the final state, and because we know there is the problem, we try to implement some finalists there and try to play with that inside dm-crypt, and actually our student did that. He's just defending the master thesis regarding today this week, so he already implemented three of the Cesar finalists. And performance with IGIS that can use implementation and hardware acceleration looks very well. So I would say that's the future of that, but we'll see. So that's the reason why I'm in our release notes I mentioned that the authenticated encryption for disk inside Lux is experimental feature. You can play with that, you can use that, but please think about that. It's just try to implement some academic idea practically, and maybe we are too fast. I was probably too practical, so you can use that now, and we have still not the crypto competition final. So anyway, how it looks practically, looks to this integrity protection, looks to here really just works as the storage, new on-disk storage, that there are no any other new features used. So the first one parameters are for that separate HMAC calculation, so length preserving modes and HMAC. The second is for the native IID mode. I use ChaCha20 with poly authentication. And you can see what happens if you just Lux format it with Lux 2. And you just need to specify cipher as in Lux, and you need to specify the integrity field, and it will format it, and then you are using it just as normal Lux device. There is no difference later. If you activate it, you can clearly see that there is some in the middle there is a stack device called test div. That's the DM integrity device providing metadata for the test device. It's completely hidden in activation, so only if you look how the system is configured, you can see that. But from the user point of view, it's hidden. If you see the status here, there are two differences. Expect that it reports the proper ciphers. For the separate HMAC authentication, you can see the separate integrity key, so it has separate independently generated key. For the authenticated mode, the key is actually just one, and it's up to the encryption mode internally how to will deal with that encryption part of the key and so on. So that's simpler. Otherwise, it's exactly the same. So I showed it, there is question how it fast and if it's usable. The main design goal was not to design something in regard to performance. We would like to design something that is secure and then try to optimize that. Anyway, because I know that academic works usually are on paper and in reality differs, we try to do something what is usable. If it's usable, it's up to you. But there are some numbers. This is picture from some paper that was rejected, so I can use that. Unfortunately, I cannot show you other pictures because I just tried to submit the paper again, and there are strange academic restrictions. So what you can see here is the field simulated load. I try to simulate something very near to worst case. And I am interleaving 70% of reads with 30% of writes, so really mixing of 8 kilobyte size, and just measuring what's happening here. The black box is the underlying device, so no encryption, just the baseline. The second one is the DM integrity, so CRC 32, and the rest are various encryption modes. So you can clearly see the problem is with the journal. Journal will drop the mix of the read writes to the half of the throughput. If we switch journal off, so no journal, the top two pictures on the top, you can see that there is some differences between the algorithms. The slowest one is, of course, the HMAC, but it's not so bad. So the real problem with this system, I should mention all the processing used hardware acceleration on Intel E7 here. So we are using ISNI, we are using specific SSE instruction and so on. So the problem is not with the algorithm, problem is with that journal. What to do with that, it depends on situation. Maybe if we stuck some file system that is doing journaling on top, we can switch the journal off, but it depends on how it will be used. So, short summary before I move to a very short introduction to Lux 2. All I describe it is already available as a code, and not only on GitHub, it's already in a released version. So the DM integrity and dm-crypt extensions are in kernel since 4.12. The user space with Lux version 2 is in cryptsetup 2.0 something. I will do probably some minor releases, but it's just entering distributions now. Fedora will have it in 28 version. Debian already have it in unstable repository. I see it for most of the architectures in that experimental state. Reason is that we have to change the ABI, so we bump basically the name of the library, so it needs to integrate it in our systems, but it's on the way. If you are playing with unstable distros, you can just install it and play with that without additional patching of the source code. The conclusion for the encryption here is that really for authenticated encryption, we need to wait for the finalist of crypto competition. I don't expect that NIST or someone will provide something better there. And then for the implementation inside the kernel, but as I said, we have already something already done, so we will see how it goes. But you can experiment with that once the thesis will be finally defended. I will send to the list link to the implementation of various authenticated algorithms so people can play with that. It's already on GitHub somewhere. What I did mention, and many of you probably are asking, why the hell I am doing it on block level? That was actually the motivation. I was waiting for a file system, a real cryptographic file system in Linux with integrity protection for years. There are some off trees, but in mainline tree there is no protection using authenticated encryption. All the encryption coming today to the kernel, X4, no discussions just last week or about XFS, all is the same encryption, length preserving encryption using XTS mode, so something we have in dm-crypt 10 years ago and we have still today. So my motivation, that's the academic motivation, is just try to motivate people. We need to implement something for the future. So yes, it should be implemented on the high level. There should be file systems using that, but why not try to do it here? And if you can see, the initial idea was in 2015. We have January, February of 2018, and we have in kernel. So it can be done. I know file systems are complicated, but yes, it should be there. I'm not discussing that. So just one idea for DM integrity. My initial idea was just implement DM integrity for existing device with that journal or that performance stuff. But I would say in future with the persistent memory, and no, I mean the real persistent memory, not the DIMM with battery or something like that, faking, just real persistent memory, you are not limited by any block size. You can just define your block size, so you can define your sector size with metadata, and then you have atomic write without any integrity stuff, and the dencrypt should work as well there with very small layer there. So that was something that I would like to see in future, but usually in storage world it's always different that people think. So that's a conclusion for this part. And if I have few minutes, I will try just short introduction to Lux version 2, but just big warning, Lux 2 was designed for several other reasons. I am still behind with documenting that, so there is just a very small documentation inside the tree, but it's about key management. All this talk was about the real encryption engine, and the Lux 2 is mainly about key management, so it's something different, just adding to this talk. So Lux 2 is actually additional format. It's not replacement for Lux 1. As I mentioned the last line, Lux 1 will be supported probably forever. If you are happy with that, it works, it's there. And the reason I need a new version is I need something where I can extensions, I can store metadata, maybe do some header redundancy, but I am not touching the key cryptographic concept inside Lux. It's the same, it's just on disk format, just is more generic, but the principles are the same. We will probably change some part of the in future, but it really requires some security analysis and so on. So for now, the logic, how the key slots are calculated, how our key derivation functions works, it's the same. What I added to Lux 2 is a new metadata format. I use JSON. And if you are scared that we use JSON for something on disk, actually it was a very good idea. I several times need to change that during the development, and it was much simpler than change any binary formats. We are using it very specific way, so we are not, we have no problem with partial update of JSON array or something like that. So that was a decision I think it was a good decision here. Don't use binary format, just metadata JSON format. And what's actually new here is Argon2 key derivation function. That would be for different talk, but Argon2 is memory hard function, so we are trying to implement something to prevent GPU acceleration for password cracking and so on. So that's another feature. And what we'd like to see in the last slide is actually something what James was talking in the talk before me, using TPMs, various tokens, and so on. I have just did one decision. Cryptsetup will never ever link to any hardware provides directly, at either TPM, various tokens, smart cards, anything. We are just not able to keep eye on all problems with that, but we try to provide some new interface how you can combine, for example, sealing the passphrase in your TPM or token and unlocking Cryptsetup or looks to format. That's actually called token concept. Token is just some JSON object, so just metadata object inside header you can add there, and that object says how I can get the passphrase for particular key slot. So instead of typing the passphrase on the command line, the header contains information, just look somewhere if there is passphrase and if there is unlock the device with that. The first concept is internal keyring token, so we are intensively using kernel keyring, and the token basically says, look to the kernel keyring, if there is keyring with this name, try to use it to unlock looks. If it works, the device is unlocked automatically and everything works. So it's up to some external application to put the passphrase to the kernel keyring. The second option is more sophisticated. I am not sure if it will use in reality, but maybe it will. You can define your own token type, so your own metadata. We are providing way how you can store it inside looks. So you can define whatever you want. And then you can operate it with, but Cryptsetup will just ignore this kind of tokens. You have to implement library for activation devices and so on. So, for example, TPM can use the first one if you have application or even the second one. Just someone need to write some external application working with that. And just my last note to TPM, it has trusted platform module, so you have to trust it, of course. I am not so sure. I'm not still convinced that these modules that are using embedded firmware can be trusted to some extent that I would like to use myself. And the reason is that I was actually sitting exactly in the same room, literally in the same room with people that found the Roka attack to TPMs. And I asked one thing that was actually in that paper not so visible. How is it possible that the manufacturer has possibility to just upgrade the firmware in the trusted platform module? If you see that Chromebooks updates, Microsoft Windows updates, TPMs, manufacturer can update firmware there. They can implant whatever they want, maybe some backdoor or something like that. And if we don't have way how to check that update key or something doesn't is not leaking and it's a firmware block. So yes, use that if you trust the manufacturer. If you are in corporate, you have to trust your notebooks anyway. But just think about that. It still contains firmware that can be upgraded. Someone can play with that. So it should be someone else's responsibility if it has problems. And apparently, in the Roka case, you can see that there was big problem with factorization of numbers. Next time, it can be with the manipulation with the keys. Anyway, just my personal opinion to that. Okay, that's all. Thanks for attention. And if you have any question, if you have time for question, anyway. If you have any questions later, just use dm-crypt mailing list so we can discuss it later.